Gotcha. Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to church and Love Month. Love Month, February. Look at your neighbor and say, you look lovely today. Right, tell your neighbor, you look lovely today. Lovely. Hey, thanks to our kids' church helpers today and Boyers for snacks. We love that this morning. Thank you. Two clipboards, kids' church helpers. And then on February 18th, we have a pizza dinner after church. February 18th is the installation of our new officers for the year. And after that, we like to celebrate by the church buys pizza dinner. And then, so on here, if you would be willing to bring something, you could bring a salad. You could bring a dessert. And we like chocolate and peanut butter, just like Boyers have back there. And set up, assist prior to church, and clean up. So I'll pass that around if you'd like to help. That's February 18th. Next Sunday, we have our annual meeting right after church. You're welcome to stay if you like. It takes about a half hour. And something else is going on next Sunday. What else is going on? What? Oh, does anybody care about the Super Bowl this year?
What kind of food?
Food. Okay, food for the Super Bowl. Got it. Anyway. Board meeting next Monday night, 12th. So that's what we have going on at church. Any other announcements this morning? All right. Well, glad you came to church. It's a nice day. Did you ask your neighbor if they enjoyed the rain instead of the snow? The rain instead of the snow. Yeah. Birthdays today. Any birthdays to celebrate? The 1st of February? No birthdays? Okay, I'm looking. Go ahead. If you're sitting by somebody you can trust or you like to tell this to, say, it's okay, there's no birthdays in church today. You look older anyway. Go ahead, tell them. You look older anyway. You look older anyway. Yeah, tell them. That's right. Yeah, come on up, guys. Come on up. Good to see you. Thanks for coming this morning. Glad you're here. Back to the family. I love that. How you doing?
Good morning.
Good to see you. Yeah. All right, anniversaries. Anybody have an anniversary in the beginning of Love Month? February? Nobody? All right, well, if you're with your sweetie, tell them thanks for sticking with me. Go ahead, tell them thanks for sticking with me. All right, this happened this week. Did you see this guy? So we have a little discussion going on about what are they called? So ask your neighbor, what would you call that? All right, here's your choices. How many say groundhog? How many say woodchuck? How many say land beaver? That's what you say? Okay. Well, I hadn't heard that one before. That was a new one this morning, but that's what they do, don't they? Anyway, did you see what he voted? Winter's over. He stayed out. It's the first time in how many years? That's why we had rain yesterday, right? Winter's over. So go ahead, tell your neighbor to put their snow shovels away and park your snow blowers. You don't have to worry about it. No worry. No worries, it's over. Oh, we're glad you're... Oh, by the way, gentlemen, this is your reminder, your week early, week and a half early reminder. What's coming on the 14th? What do we celebrate? It's a Hallmark holiday, and it's called what? Valentine's Day. Okay, guys, you got a week and a half before Valentine's Day. Can you do it?
Yeah.
All right, you can do it. Well, I'm glad you came to church. Love month, love month. Hey, we're going to start with our song of prayer this morning. We always pray and ask God to bless us for worship. Bless us for worship. This morning. Almighty Father in heaven, living Lord Jesus and Holy Spirit, it's an honor, a privilege, a blessing to be here this morning to worship together as a church family and to praise your glorious name, Father in heaven. You've blessed us, you've watched over, you've answered prayers, you've helped us, and Father, there are still many prayers and cares to be thinking about, but God, you have done that. You have made all things in the way they should be, and we trust you, and we put our lives in your hands again today. So thank you, Lord, for each one who could be here this morning, and for many who can't be here, we pray over them as well for various reasons. But God bless our time today of worshiping you and studying and knowing you better. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Hey, take your hymnal. Turn to number 240. We're going to stand and sing a love song. Love lifted me. Number 240 in your hymnal. Let's stand together and sing. All right, three verses. Here we go. I was sinking deep in sin, far from a peaceful shore. Very deep we stayed within, sinking to highs no more. But the master of the sea, my heart is very bright. From the waters lifted me, now safe am I. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When darkly blessed out, love lifted me. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When I'm in desperate, love lifted me. All my heart to him I give, ever to him I'll sing. In his blessed presence here, ever his praise to sing. Love so mighty and so true, there's my soul's best song. Faithful
loving service to you. Love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me.
All right, when we do the chorus on verse 3, you got to reach to your neighbor's elbow just a little bit and just give him a little lift, okay? Love. If you love your neighbor, give them a little lift when we sing the chorus on verse 2. Just a little one, not too hard. Be gentle. Here we go, verse 3.
Souls in danger look above. Jesus completely saves. He will lift you by his arm out of the angry waves. He's the master of the sea. Angels his will obey. He's your savior, wants to be his.
All right, give a little lift.
Love lifted me.
Just a little.
Love lifted me. When nothing else could help. Love,
a little lift, a little lift.
Love lifted me. Love lifted me. When nothing else could help. Love lifted me.
Oh, you're all a bunch of weirdos. Give each other a hug and kiss. Tell you, Jesus loves you. Jesus loves you. So answer the question. You got 8 seconds to talk to your neighbor. How do I know if someone loves me? What are the ways you know if someone loves you? Go ahead. Got 8 seconds. Talk to your neighbor. How do you know if someone loves you? How do you know if someone loves you? Tricky, tricky, tricky. Here's one for you. I like this. Now, you've seen it before, some of you. I love you from my head to my what? Yeah. We've been talking about overcoming this last month, January. We'll finish up in February, overcoming certain things in our lives. And today we talk about some stuff about overcoming that has to do with some fears in our world. So we want to sing this song as a reminder. And here we go.
Every anxious thought that steals my breath, it's a heavy weight upon my chest. As I lie awake and wonder what the future will hold, help me to remember that you're in control. Hey, you're my courage when I worry in the dead of night. You're my strength, cause I'm not strong enough to win this fight. You are greater than the battle raging in my mind. I will trust you, Lord. I will fear no more. I will lift my eyes, lift my hands, lay them in your hands. I'll leave them there. When the wind and waves are coming, you shelter me. Even though I'm in the storm, the storm is not in me. You're my courage when I worry in the dead of night. You're my strength, cause I'm not strong enough to win this fight. You are greater than the battle raging in my mind. I will trust you, Lord. I will fear no more. Oh, I will fear no more. Oh, I will fear no speak, cause you have overcome. No darkness can overwhelm, cause you've already won. No power can come against me, cause you have overcome. No darkness can overwhelm me, cause you've already won. You're my courage when I'm worried in the dead of night. You're my strength cause I'm not strong enough to win this fight. You are greater than the battle raging in my mind. I will trust you, Lord. I will be
Jesus. We got Jesus, don't we? All right. How do I know if I am in love with someone? Okay. You only got 5 seconds to talk about this with your neighbor. So make it really fast. How do you know if you're in love with someone? Go, go, go. We got 5 seconds. All right. That's enough. That was more than 5 seconds. Hey, here. Here's some guidelines for you. Number one, do you think about the person often? You just can't get them out of your mind. Number two, do you want to please that person? Somehow make them happy. I don't know why I'm talking in a dramatic, romantic voice, but I just want you to have that thought in your head. Number three, do you want to make a good impression on this person in your appearance and your conduct? So you're putting a little extra cologne on, perhaps. That's refreshing when you do that. Number four, do you like to spend all your time with that person? Number five, do you have complete trust in them? Number six, do you want to make this person happy and give them gifts? Number seven, in your thoughts, does your presence and future center on this person? Oh, it must mean love. So here's how it looks when you're in love with somebody and you're all gonna say, oh no. Have you seen that before? I can't help it. I cannot stop showing this picture in February. Look at him. That little tongue on that dog, he's sticking out of his mouth. And this one I can't help but show either because this is love. It's love for whatever you put in your mouth. Probably peanut butter. Eric and Marisol, that's love right there. Probably from a wolfhound. All right. Tell your neighbor, somebody loves you more than a dog. Go ahead, tell your neighbor, somebody loves you more than a dog. Yeah. Hey, this song is called Knowing You. It's about knowing Jesus, of course, and we just want to sing it together. It's great. All I want is help, dear, build my life apart. All this world fears and wars to all I once thought gain, I have counted lost, spent and worthless now compared to this. Knowing you, Jesus, knowing you, there is no greater thing. You're my all, you're the best, you're my joy, my righteousness, and my love. Is to know you more, to be found in you, and known as yours, to possess my faith, what I could not earn, also passing gift of righteousness. Knowing you, Jesus,
live and never die. Knowing you, Jesus, knowing you, there is no greater thing. You're my all, you're the best, you're my joy, my righteousness, and I love you, Lord.
Words of that song are great, aren't they? What images come to your mind when you think about how much God loves you? What do you think of? What do you think of? God loves me. What do you think of? Something like that? Something like that? Something like that? Maybe that verse at the end of 1 Corinthians 13 falls into your head. These three remain. Faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is what? God loves us, doesn't he? I'm going to ask you to stand with me. We'll sing this prayer. Where the boys and girls come. We'll sing it through twice this morning. The names of our Savior, the names of Jesus.
His name is Master, Savior, Lion of Judah, Blessed Prince of Peace, Shepherd, Fortress, Rock of Salvation, Lamb of God is He. Son of David, King of the ages, eternal life. Holy Lord of glory, His name is Lion.
These are His names.
His name is Master, Savior, Lion of Judah, Blessed Prince of Peace, Shepherd, Fortress, Rock of Salvation, Lamb of God is He. Son of David, King of the ages, eternal life. Holy Lord of glory, His name is Life.
I believe Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Amen?
Amen.
He forgave my sins. Amen?
Amen?
He saved me from eternal separation from God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And He gives me everlasting life. Amen?
Amen?
Amen. Time for the boys and girls. Time for the boys and girls to come up. Time for the boys and girls to come up. Hey, come on. Hi, David. Anybody else? Come? Hi, come on in. How are you?
Good.
Anybody have any colds going around? Anybody have strep throat? Sore ears? Anybody have the Brett's?
No.
No?
What's the Brett's?
What's the Brett's? That's the sound you make when you Brett.
What's a Brett?
Brett. Good. Okay, well, I'm glad you're here at church. But some people aren't feeling very good, are they? We got to pray for them. Father, thank you for the boys and girls here today. Thank you for their mom and dads, papas and nanas. We pray if anybody's feeling yucky today at home, that you, God, you would help just heal them and get them over those bugs going around. Thank you for being with us, Father, in good times and bad times. And just like Job, we receive the good times and we'll receive the tough times as well, Father, from you. And we thank you for it all. We love you today. Thank you for loving us. In Jesus' name we pray. Will you pray the Lord's Prayer with me?
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. On earth as it is in heaven,
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let's sing. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Thank you for our kids' church helpers this morning. Thank you for them. All right, turn and tell your neighbor what kind of Valentine's you got when you were in school. What do you get in your Valentine box when you're in school? Tell your neighbor. Yeah, what'd you get? How many of you in school made those shoebox things that the kids had to put there? You did that? How many just brought a bag and held it up there? Yeah, this is fun. That's next week, but you got to start thinking about it. Preparing for Valentine's Day. It's a big deal. Hey, we want to pray some this morning. We've got some praises to pray about. And we sent out an email yesterday, little Dario, Antonio and Bailey Cabrera's little guy, is in the hospital with RSV and rhinovirus. And he's going home this morning. Yeah, praise God. So, answers to prayer, and we're very happy about that. You never know. Oxygen levels are so touchy, aren't they, in little people? So we're going to pray for him. Speaking of oxygen, Billy.
Yes, I would just have to ask for some prayers for Roy. He's not been able to be here this morning, but just ask for his prayers that he was becoming very lethargic and pale. Thursday of last week, and he got admitted into the hospital because he's severely anemic and low on iron.
Yeah.
And so they've been giving him blood transfusions and trying to determine where the blood is going, because when you are anemic, blood's going somewhere. And it's probably internal bleeding from medication complications or something like that. So,
yep.
So he's still in the hospital. He thought he was going to get to come home last night, but the hemoglobin levels won't stay up. Just ask for your prayers.
Yeah, so Roy's in the hospital in Scottsbluff, Torrington. He's in the hospital with anemia and just having trouble keeping those blood levels up. So we want to pray for Roy, and thank you for letting us know. We want to pray for Jim and Lori, Heather's parents. We've been praying for them, having medical difficulties, both of them struggling. Carrie asked us to pray for Shelley. In the hospital, she, diabetic, had some problems with the insulin medications, and so we want to pray for her. And then Carrie asked us to pray for Amber. Would be a family member who is having a battle with cancer as well. And we want to do that too. So I'm going to add them to our list. So we want to pray for a few minutes for these folks and just thank God for his goodness to us and that he will be with them. Father in heaven, we bow our prayers today, and we give you praises right away for Dario's improvements and that he gets to go home, and we're very grateful for that. God, you are faithful to us, and sometimes we only attribute that to the good times, but also in the tough times, God, you are still there. And so we think about Roy this morning, and we pray for him and this anemia that he's fighting with and all that's going on in him. We just pray that they're able to be successful and find that in the hospital here this morning in Torrington. God, help them. Thank you for our medical teams for persisting and caring and searching. And Lord, thank you for guiding them. Pray for Jim and Lori today. We've been praying for these folks, and God, just ask your healing upon them, your care and watching over them. We pray for Shelley this morning, and we pray for Amber. Lord, we lift these folks to you. And Father, I would ask that your spirit would be sent to them to give not only encouragement and healing and help, but a lot of love this morning too, that they know that you are with them. So, Father, we pray for these folks. We lift them to you today in the name of Jesus, our Savior. Amen.
Yes.
Amen. Jack sent me a note. We prayed for his sister last Sunday at this time. Jack, you want to tell us?
She come out of the double lung transplant really well. She will be released from the hospital on Tuesday to go into aftercare.
Yeah. So last Sunday at this time, she was having a double lung transplant, and she's already getting ready to go to care. Yeah. Right on. Prayers. Yep, we thank God. God, thank you for helping Jack's sister and her recovery. We pray for those infections and acceptance of all of these transplants. But God, we just thank you for your answers to prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We never know. We don't know, do we? Anyone else? Sandy? Oh, fire. Family in Morrill lost their house Friday night to a fire. Father, this is a devastating kind of thing. We just pray over this family and the loss of possessions, but yet, Lord, a loss of home, loss of place. And what do you do? So, God, please help them. Let them feel the joy and love in the community and help them, guide them on their new path, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Yeah. All right. Glad you're here this morning. Thank you for coming. I know I say that a lot, but I really mean it. It's nice that you're here. This week, Glenn and Ross and Terry and I put those cupboards in back there, and it's really nice. And so Glenn's not here this morning. They'll be gone, but I want to thank them publicly for doing that. And I think it's pretty cool. But when I hang around here during the week by myself, did some of you not see him? How many even noticed the cupboards in the corner? I like it. How many noticed the trees are almost down next door? Only part of one. One person asked me critically this morning why we were leaving that part up. And I said, because we want to put Christmas lights on that part next year. No, Brian, it's okay. I love you, man. It was all in fun. I love that. So things are changing and happening. But I think it's really cool and stuff like that. But you gotta know, when I'm here by myself during the week, it's just not as wonderful. It's not as great. I'm telling you, you make all the difference. So elbow your neighbor and say, you make all the difference in church. Go ahead, tell your neighbor. You make all the difference. All right, we're going to this topic this morning. Turn to John chapter 10, verses 14 through 16. John chapter 10, 14 through 16. And I want you to read out loud with your neighbor these few verses. So if you're in the red Bible, it's page 1667. If you've got a maroon Bible, it's page 1528. And do we know when we hear Jesus' voice, when he's talking to us? Do we know that? So I want you to read that out loud with your neighbor, okay? Go, go, go. Go, read, read, read. I am the good shepherd. Verse 14. Is that the first time Jesus says that? No. If you back up to verse 11, you see it again, don't you? Jesus says, I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me. I haven't done much work with sheep in my lifetime. Anybody here ever been a sheep herder or a shepherd? A few of you? Sheep are interesting animals. I love it when they get sheared off in the spring and get all that wool off of them, then they look great, don't they? So we've been talking about spiritual challenges for the last several weeks here, and we're thinking about another challenge this morning. I'll show you where the list comes from in a minute. If you're visiting today or you haven't been here before, once you understand where it's all coming from. But we've been looking at these ideas of spiritual challenges in our lives at the beginning of 2024. And how do we overcome those challenges? And so this one today we're talking about, the next one in the verses we're looking at is this one of practicing magic arts. And when we talk about that, we think, I'm not really a practitioner. Maybe you, I don't know. So we're going to talk about what is that and some of the ideas around it. And then how do we overcome these things? What's really some ideas about this that I need to watch out for in my life with God? Because here's the real issue. In all of my life, it's not just about this one topic. We've talked about lots of other things you'll see on the list. But just in my life as a whole, will I choose to live for God and try to do that every day? And as I choose to live for God, am I going to follow what He says to do? Or in my life, I can choose to live for myself. I can choose to live the things of the world. I can even choose to live for the enemy if I so choose to do that. I remember being the chaplain out of the prison. We had a group of people who used the chapel for worship, and they were Satanists. And so when they came in, they would have their satanic rituals. They made a choice, a conscious choice, to live and worship Satan. So our options are whatever we choose. But what are the best options? And so we're talking about those kind of things today. So the word that came to mind is this way, commit my ways to the Lord. And you're in church this morning, so it's an assumption that I make that probably most of your life you want to submit or commit our ways to God. Is that fair for me to assume? And I love that. And if you aren't sure about committing to God, maybe you're here just searching and thinking about it. Well, then that's where we're at today. So our verses we were looking at about where this came from is in Revelations 21, clear at the end of the Bible. And John, the Apostle John, wrote these words given to him from the Lord. Verse 6 talks about we can inherit all of the things in heaven and earth that will be new when God takes over. Or we will miss out in verse 8 if we do these things. So we'll look at those lists. Now everyone who believes, 1 John chapter 5 tells us, everyone who believes in Jesus as the Son of God will overcome these kind of things. And we'll follow the commands that God gives us. And the commands are not even a burden. We're happy to do the things that God asks us to do. So in 1 John chapter 5, everyone who believes gets to be relieved of that burden. But here's what I know. When we commit our ways to God, it means something needs to change. And I'm still finding those things in my life. I first know that I asked Jesus in my life when I was 5 years old. At 5 years old, I was a dirty, rotten sinner. You can't believe the things I had done by the time I was 5 years old. It doesn't really matter, does it? Even if I broke one of the commandments, by the time I was five, I was still a sinner. I was still separated from God. But I remember giving my life to Jesus at that time, praying with my family, and asking Jesus to come into my heart and forgive my sins. So something has to change, and over my time, some things have changed easily, some things have changed hard. Some things I like to hang on to, even now, about the world or things I like. So here's the list of items we've been looking at. In Revelation chapter 21, it gives us this list of things. It says, these cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. And the first one was cowardly, second was unbelieving, then vile, then murderers, sexually immoral. And this week, we talk about practitioners of magic arts. Next week, we'll talk about idolaters. And that seems very fitting to me on Super Bowl Sunday. So it'll be an easy time to talk about it, okay? Go ahead, elbow your neighbor and say, it'll be okay, it'll be okay, it'll be okay. Practitioners of magic arts. So today, we're going to talk about that. So it's number 6 on the list. So how do we know if we're practicing magic arts? Am I fascinated or captivated with the things that are seemingly in the magic world? White or black magics, doesn't matter. Am I captivated by those things? Do I use tools that are not of God, but rather of Satan? Are my thoughts in control or kind of out of control about how I live my life? Is the things I'm doing leading me to God, or are they leading me away from God? And that's kind of a guiding path or statement that I can ask myself all throughout the day. Is what I'm about to say leading me closer to God or leading me away from God? Is what I'm about to do leading me closer to God or away from God? Some things don't matter because I'm just going to work. Sometimes it really does matter. Magic arts don't really have a definition that we give to it per se, but rather it has to do with media, tools, or devices that lead to acts of following Satan and turning away from God. So do these things allow me to receive God's blessings? And what I'll tell you from the straight up is the things that happen in the world of magic lead us away from God, and they take away the blessings that he brings. Okay? Now, they seem to have some of their own charm and benefits, but they take away. So here's just kind of a picture overall of some things that we refer to in the magic world as devices, instruments, or types of tools. So you pick out a couple on there and you say, what do you think? I'm just going to go through examples. So these things are just things that are out there that can be of that magic art nature, okay? So we've got things like cards, you know those. We've got things like Ouija boards. These are things that are of the dark arts. We've got wands. We've got magic tools, different types of things. You've seen symbols. Books of spells. Horoscope type things. Now, I use some kid books just to show, but there are lots of books out in that are reading, whether fiction or nonfiction, that we think about. Are these things leading me towards God or away from God? We got movies, all kinds of movies. Horror movies. It's not Halloween. I don't even want to ask how many like horror movies. I can't watch them. I get too scared. We got games that go on that don't bring us closer to God. And I know about these things from there. But when I was a kid, this is one of my favorite shows on TV. Do you remember this show? How many watch this show? How many of you have watched this show who are less than 30 years old? Raise your hands. Oh, there's one of you. Probably on YouTube. This came out a long time ago, didn't it? You remember when you even watched it? And what they never used bad words in the show. Do you remember that? There were no bad words. They were a married couple. They were together. It was always helpful. And I looked at it at the time as so much fun because she would do what with her nose? She'd wiggle her nose and something magical would happen. And it was never mean or harsh, was it? Do you remember that? I mean, I would have taken a few times and I'd blown somebody's socks off, literally. Bing, 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 pow. But the same is true if I go back in generations and we follow those processes of things, how these kind of shows have changed today, right? So we look at number 6, practitioners of magic. Am I involved in these things more than I should be, perhaps? That's kind of the question we're looking at. Am I involved more in these things than I am in reading God's word or spending time with people who love me? I don't know. 1 John chapter 5, we're talking about that word overcome. Who is it that overcomes the world? Only the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God. This phrase, knowing Christ as my Savior, gives me power over all darkness. There's no darkness that stands against Jesus, right? And we're going to look at some of those today. So, here we go. Biblical teachings about the magic art. And remember, it's all for the sake of helping go to heaven, people go to heaven. That's what this is all about. I just want to show you a list of things that in the Bible, there's 30 different verses that showed up easy that talk about things about magic in the Bible. And they distinctly refer to them different than miracles. They're not the same thing, okay? So just so you know, the Bible's full of this, and you can Google it. It's easy to find. I picked out just a few things to reference today. In the Old Testament, in the book of 1 Samuel, chapter 28, Saul was king back then, and Samuel had died, and he didn't have anybody to tell him to predict what was going to happen when he went to war with the Philistines. And so Saul was afraid. So in his quest for trying to know if they're going to survive this battle or not, he goes to this witch of Endor and he seeks her help. And she sees the future by foretelling, but she was not of God. And the judgments that come out of this are very powerful for them and changes the whole of Saul's reign as king. It's kind of a turning point in his whole life. So just this idea in 1 Samuel where Saul was going to God and visiting with the prophets, and then he went and consulted with the dark ones, and it changed things for them. In the Gospels, we have different stories of Jesus casting out demons, and one of the stories that all of us maybe think about is Mark chapter 5 sometime. Mark chapter 5, Jesus was visiting a community, and out in the cemetery, they had chained a man, but he had broken the chains that held him. Do you remember what his name was? His name was Legion. When Jesus approached him, he said, "I am Legion," for he had 1,000 demons in him, and no one could control him, and he couldn't wear clothing, and he was just a savage of a man, we have this description, living out in the cemetery and causing chaos in the community. And so when Jesus approached him right away, he said, "Son of man." And Jesus said to him, and he says, "Please don't send us back there. Send us to the pigs." And Jesus says to the demons, "Go to the pigs." A herd of pigs received the demons, and they all went into the water, and they all drowned in the lake. And we've thought about that for over time, and just thinking about over the next several weeks with all these dead pigs in the water, what the smell in the community probably turned to be. And not only that, but the loss of food source. And the community got so frustrated at Jesus for doing this, for rescuing this crazy man who lived out in the cemetery and destroying their food source, that they asked Jesus to leave. "Please go away." But the reality of it is, our souls are more important than our economy. The soul of a person is way more valuable than our economic value. New Testament, Acts chapter 16. We see a story of a slave girl who's a fortune teller who has a spirit. And as she's doing this, Paul is coming there and he's visiting the community. And she walks behind him and she keeps yelling. He says, "This man is from God. He's from God." And he keeps yelling. And finally, Paul gets tired of those words and he turns around and he casts the demon out. He says, "You go away." And when he does this, he destroys her ability to tell the future about people. And so her master got very mad because he was now going to lose his income because the demon was gone. Now, these are stories in the Bible, right? But I hold the Bible as a pretty reliable historic source, and the authors were careful in the things of it. So when we think about these stories in the Bible and this practicing of magic and the ideas of it, the Bible is very clear about witchcraft, sorcery. We don't need it. I don't need it. I don't need to touch it. Meditations, tarot, oracles, breath work, yogas, crystal. Now be careful, yoga is good exercise, so I don't want you to freak out on some of these, right? But the idea is, I trust God first, right? Do you trust God first? Or do you put your trust in something in the world? Galatians chapter 5 says, "The acts of the sinful nature are obvious. Sinful immorality," we talked about that last week, "impurities, debauchery, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambitions, dissensions, factions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this cannot have the kingdom of heaven." So that's why we talk about it. Now, this is kind of a negative side of it, isn't it? Are you going through that list saying, "Well, me, no, not me, not me, not me"? This is the beginning of love month, isn't it? So look at your neighbor and say, "Jesus loves you." Go ahead, tell your neighbor, "Jesus loves you. Jesus loves you." Jesus loves us so much. He loves us so much that none of the things we've just talked about can soil our soul so badly that he cannot forgive us. You got that? That's what this is about this morning. Nothing you can do is so terrible that Jesus cannot wash it away. So if you've been there in some of those places, fine. It's for you to travel with God on your journey. Where are you and what things need to change in your life? The Spirit of God will help you know that. But do I need some of these things? Some people say that Jesus did magic as miracles, but miracles were classified as an act of a divine God to intervene into our world in a supernatural way. And so we don't refer to those miracles as magic. We refer to them as miracles. There's a clear distinction in Scripture about those two different things. Even Jesus himself was confronted by Satan, the evil one, who no doubt has tempted us. You remember those three temptations in the desert? Jesus went out for 40 days and 40 nights. He didn't eat anything, right? He was praying and preparing for ministry. And while he did that, The devil came to him at the end of that time and says to him, turn the stones into bread. I know you're hungry. And then he took Jesus to that high place of the temple, and he says, jump and call for God's protection. And finally, he took him to the mountain, and he showed him all of this, and he said, you can have all of this, the authority of the world. Satan was going to give it to him. The temptations were the lust of the flesh. I need bread. I need something to eat. Jesus said, no, I trust in God. The pride of life is having the kingdoms and the people and all that we can have to follow us. Look at the pride of life, even as this is an election year. Do you see it coming out already? It's crazy, isn't it? And the third one was the lust of the eyes. Do I get to have everything? Do I trust Satan more than I trust God? And Jesus said each three times to Satan, what did he say? No. 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 The power of the Spirit of God gives us that ability as well. We can overcome those same temptations and same struggles. So how do I help people go to heaven? Am I good enough to help people go to heaven? I mean, if I'm having these problems with sin, am I that good? Or maybe I'm not good enough. It's simple. No matter where you're at, we do it by living and practicing our beliefs. Not magic. We just keep going in our faith walk. We walk by faith, not by sight. Faith is being sure of what we hope for and certain. Even if I can't see it, I know God's there. Our faith practices include these kind of things. Loving God first and then loving each other, right? My faith practice is prayer. Do we pray every day? Do I read my Bible every day? We come and meet together in church, in giving to help others, and then in serving in different ways. These are things we do as our faith practices. Because why? Because we love God. Because we've committed our lives to God. Because He loves us. Are the Ten Commandments important? They are. They are still important. Is the greatest commandment important? Love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, strength, and your neighbor as yourself. You better say it again. Tell your neighbor, I love you almost as much as I love myself. Go ahead, tell your neighbor, I love you almost as much as I love myself. You know why you have to say that? Did you comb your hair today or did you comb your neighbor's hair? When you love your neighbor as much as yourself, you'll comb their hair first. Now, it's easy for Monty's family because he doesn't have any hair to comb. And a few others of you. Look at this one. Look at this one. 1 Corinthians chapter 6. Look at this verse. Now, if I just stop at the beginning of it and I don't finish it, look what it says. Everything is permissible for me. Stop. Is that true? It is true. I can do whatever I want. But not everything is beneficial. Everything is permissible, but I will not be mastered by any of the things around me. I will only be mastered by the King of Heaven. So my prayer of salvation that I pray, Lord Jesus, have mercy on me, for I'm a sinner. I need to remind you today that I'm a professional hypocrite and you're only a bunch of amateurs. Because I sin too, right? There's only one person who didn't. And who was that? Our Savior Jesus. He's the only one who did not sin. So I pray and I ask him, Lord Jesus, have mercy on me, for I am a sinner. I believe you are the Son of God. I believe you forgive my sins. I believe you will give me everlasting life. So come into my life and save me. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. You read it, John chapter 10. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. It's really the bottom line when we talk about magic arts is, which direction are you going with your life? Are we following and trusting Christ for our salvation? Are we putting our life into other things of the world? What is it going to be? That's all the question that God asks. But you never go wrong when we follow Jesus. The most famous verse in the Bible is followed by one that I want you to hear today, because I'm not being judgmental or condemning. I've walked with you on these roads. I've watched the movies and read the stories. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, right? Whoever believes in that Son, Jesus, shall not perish, but will have life forever. We know that, don't we? How great is that verse? But the second verse is verse 17 that follows it. Look what it says. For God did not send Jesus Christ into the world to bring condemnation upon us. He isn't sitting there looking at us today and saying, all right, on the list of things, you've done 1, 2, 7, 8, you got to change these. That's not what Jesus is about. Jesus is about saying, look, I have really great blessings for you. If you follow me, they're yours. So come. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might have salvation. That's us. When we come to Jesus, we have the guarantee of everlasting life. Forever. It's pretty amazing, isn't it? That's a miracle. When you open your life to Christ, a miracle has been done. It doesn't mean we don't struggle with things of the world. It doesn't mean we don't have sinful thoughts or times or moments, but it means we're moving away from those things of the world towards Jesus. That's what we're doing. You're amazing and wonderful. You need to feel it. So I want you to bend your arm just like this at a 90 degree. Bend your arm at a 90 degree. You got it? Bend your arm at a 90 degree. Now put it under your neighbor's arm and give him a little lift. Go ahead. Give him a little lift. And then say, love lifted me. Go ahead, say it. Love lifted me. Love lifted me. It's like being pulled out of the mud, isn't it? Love lifted me. I love you. We're going to take our hymnal, turn to number 490. We're going to stand and sing Jesus Loves Me, and I want to pray before we sing. 490. 490. There are several verses, so you say, oh, I know that song, but there's a few more verses. We want to sing them all this morning because I want you to hear how great that song is again and again. Second most popular song in the world. You know what the first one is? Amazing. Right on. I want to pray. If you feel comfortable with the person next to you, take their hand or put your hand on the shoulder or something, and we'll pray for each other. Almighty Father in heaven, we worship you just as Jesus told us to do. And Lord Jesus, we receive you just as you asked when you said, come to me. And Spirit of God, we invite you into our lives that we may live the way you would like us to and be with God forever. So I pray for my church family this morning. Lord, your love, your peace is upon us, your guidance for our paths. Today may not be somebody's struggle, this topic or subject, but maybe one of the others is. And I just pray, Father, that we learn through your grace to overcome the things that are bogging us down in this new year. Help us to overcome by our belief, our faith in Jesus Christ. Lord, we want to live above the mud of the world. We want to know you, and we want to help people find their way to heaven. So I pray that you give us this week, you keep us from the evil one, and you let us shine your light wherever we go, in Jesus' name. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. All right, let's sing Jesus Loves Me. Four verses. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to
in me long. They are weak, but He is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me.
Verse 2.
Jesus loves me, He who died, heaven's gate to open wide. He will wash away my sin, let the little child come in. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so. Jesus loves me still, though I'm very weak and ill, from His shining come to watch me where I lie. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me.
And the last verse, thanks for coming again. Give lots of hugs on the way out. It's Love Month. And don't forget Valentine's, guys. You got a week and a half. Week and a half. Verse 4, here we go.
Jesus loves me, He must stay close beside me all the way. If